Romans chapter 5 in your Bibles. If not, that's fine. The scripture will be on the outline or on the screen. But Romans chapter 5, today we're going to be looking at chapter 5, verses 3 through 5. We're going to look at that in a few moments. I want to talk to you today about character. But before we do that, let's do our pledge to the Bible. You ready? Hold your Bible up. Say, here we go. I believe that my Bible is the Word of God.
Is the Word of God.
I will love it.
I will learn it.
I will live it. To the glory of God.
To the glory of God.
Amen. That's our commitment to the Word of God. Today I want us to look at the subject of how God develops Christian character. Now, when you get saved, when you receive Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, that's the moment that God begins to work on you. When you get saved, that's when he begins to work on you.
Amen.
See, nobody is born full grown. In other words, when you come into this world, you come as a what?
A tiny little baby,
amen? And you have to grow up. There's all kinds of things that happen to help you grow up.
Amen.
All kinds of stuff that happens. For the first time since you left your mother's womb, you know what it is to be hungry. And so what do you do as a baby?
Cry
because you're hungry. There's something you need. You know you can't grow without food. You just instinctively know it. Amen?
Amen.
But you got to grow. Babies need to grow up. So after you got saved, after your new birth in Christ, you also have to grow up in Christ. And so God has to build your Christian character. He has to build that to help you grow in Christ. Now, in order for you to even have a Christian character, you must first of all receive Christ. You can't have a Christian character without Christ. Now, I say that because there are some folks who try to develop Christian characters, but they have no base or foundation to build it on. These are those who say, I'm Christian, and they try to act Christian in certain ways, but they have no base. They're not really Christian. They don't have any base to grow their Christian character on. That's why Jesus can tell us that we're known by our fruit. Amen?
Amen.
Because they just can't seem to get the right kind of fruit because they aren't really saved. Years ago, I read about a missionary who was with her husband, and with her husband moved into a missionary home in a particular place in a city in South Africa to do missionary work there. And she wanted to make her home as pretty as she could, possibly make it, because she was used to Western standards. And so she looked at the floor of her house, and the floor just seemed dirty. It just seemed like a dirty floor. And so she said to herself, well, the first thing I'm going to do is to scrub this floor. And so she got her big brush, and she got her suds, and she got her pail, and she got down on her hands and knees, and she began to just really scrub the floor in that house. She scrubbed and scrubbed and scrubbed and mopped and rinsed and scrubbed and scrubbed and mopped and rinsed and scrubbed and scrubbed and mopped and rinsed and so on. And finally she just stopped and she said, I'm never going to get the dirt off of this floor. Well, then one of the locals who happened by just walked in. He said, look, I need to tell you something. The reason you can't get the dirt off the floor is because it is a dirt floor. It's a dirt floor. See, what she had been doing was scrubbing a floor that was dirt. Now, it was hard-packed clay, so it looked like a floor, but it was still nothing more than just dirt. So she couldn't possibly get the dirt off the floor because that's all that was on the floor. It was just dirt. Now, some people, they try to develop character like that. They scrub and they rub and they wash and they rinse and they mop and they dry. But folks, there's no other foundation there to scrub until you're born again.
Amen.
You just can't. You've got to have a new foundation in your life. But once you've been saved, once you've accepted Christ as your personal Savior and Lord, then upon that foundation, then upon that base, you can build a Christian character. Look at Romans 3, chapter 5, verses 3 through 5. Here, Romans 5, 3 through 5, because this passage tells us how God builds Christian character. This is how it happens. Paul says, here's how it occurs. Here we go. And not only that, he says, but we also glory in tribulations. Oh, did you catch that? We do what?
Glory
in tribulations. We glory in trouble and trials and hard times. The reason we can do that is knowing that tribulation, those troubles, those hard times are going to produce perseverance. Are you with me so far?
Yes.
Trouble is producing the perseverance, and perseverance then produces character, and character then produces hope. Now, hope does not disappoint because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. In other words, the reason we can have this Christ-like character is because now we've got Christ living in us. Amen?
Amen.
That's what he's saying. Now, when you give your heart to Jesus, you don't just automatically have a Christian character, or a Christ-like character. You have a basis for a Christian character, but that character has to be developed in you now by God. Has to be developed by the work of the Holy Spirit in you. Look at the next verse, Philippians 1:6. I love this verse, Paul said, and I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring about its completion at the day of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The day of Jesus Christ means when Christ returns, which could be any day now. Amen?
That's right.
So that's when it's going to be complete. So God begins a work in you at the moment of your salvation, but it's not going to be fully complete until the day that you're in the very presence of Jesus Christ himself. So when you get saved, that's when God begins a good work in you. So you are not a finished product yet.
Amen.
You're still a work that's going on. As a matter of fact, a while back I saw a man wearing a lapel button. I love this. He was wearing a lapel button that said this. It said, please be patient with me. God's not finished with me yet. I love that. I think that's true about all of us. Amen? Please be patient with me. God's not finished with me yet. Would you turn to the person next to you and say, God's not finished with me yet? Just tell him that. God's not finished with me yet. Be patient, all right? He's still working on me. Just be patient. Yeah, I like that. That's good. Kids, you can tell your parents tell the kids. See, tell them, God's not finished with me. Be patient. It's going to be okay. It's going to be all right. It'll be all right. Listen, God said he who began a good work in you will complete it, though. That is, that he's going to build in you a Christian or Christ-like character. It's going to happen one way or another. It's going to happen. So that brings up the question, well, then how does God build that Christian character? How does he do it? I wrote this on your outline. There are four steps God uses to build Christian character. And these steps are found right here in today's passage. And so number one is this. God allows pressures to come. Just write that in there. God allows pressures to come. Hey, Alicia, could you turn on the AC a bit, please? God allows pressures to come. Just write that in there. God allows pressures to come. Now, look at the next verse, Romans 5:3. It says, and not only that, but we also glory in tribulations. We also glory in tribulations. Now, the implication there is that tribulations will come, and we ought to be glad about that.
Amen.
In fact, here's the next key thought in your outline there. The word tribulation literally means pressures. It means pressures. That's what tribulation means. It means pressures. We're experiencing pressure today, aren't we?
Mm-hmm.
The Greek word for tribulations was a word that they would use whenever they would crush grapes in a wine press, or whenever they would crush olives. If they wanted grape juice or olive oil, first of all, the grapes and the olives had to go through tribulation. They had to be crushed. They had to go through pressure. Now, God wants juice and oil coming out of your character as well. God wants the oil of gladness. He wants the juice of joy. He wants that which will give strength and sustenance to others to come out of you.
Amen.
He wants it to come out of you. And the only way that God will get it out of you is to press it out of you.
Amen.
God has to press it out of you. So Paul says we glory in tribulation. Now listen, is something bad happening to you right now? Are there bad things, tough things happening to you right now?
Amen.
Are you having troubles of any kind?
Amen.
Are you feeling pressures coming upon you right now? If we think about us as a culture, as Christianity as a culture, we can say that's true about every one of us right now. Amen?
Amen.
Cultural pressures are just crowding in on us. Listen, these things are not obstacles. They are opportunities. These are opportunities for us. These are things that God has engineered for you in order to build character in your life. Now, maybe you can't understand that, and maybe you might even think that what you're going through is just bad luck. But it's not. It's not. I've heard some people say, well, if it wasn't for bad luck, I wouldn't have any luck at all. Well, you got it half right. You don't have any luck at all. Amen? Because look, I wish we could just get the word luck kind of right out of our Christian vocabulary. As children of God, we should get eliminated. I know every once in a while we may use the word luck as a way to express our encouragement for someone. I mean, we'll say, hey, good luck in your endeavors. And we'll say phrases like that. But listen, the word luck is never used in the Bible because God doesn't depend on luck.
Amen.
He doesn't. And neither do we as his children. We don't depend on luck. Yeah. Listen, we don't need something as impotent as luck because we've got God directing our lives. The Bible says all things work together for good to them that love God and call according to his purpose. God directs us. Amen?
Amen?
See, our God is a sovereign God who is involved in every single aspect of our lives. And if you can't understand why it is that you're having to go through something, if you can't understand it, then just stand under it. If you can't understand it, at least stand under it, because you don't have to understand it. You don't have to fully understand everything that happens to you. Amen? You don't. The great pilgrim Thomas Watson said this. It's the next quote on your outline there. But Thomas Watson said, where reason cannot wade, there faith must swim.
Amen.
I like that. In other words, if you can't understand what you're going through, then you're just going to have to trust God. It takes faith.
Amen. Amen.
If you're thinking about giving your heart and life to Jesus Christ, or if you're already a Christian, listen, I just want to tell you, don't think that the Christian life is all honey and no bees. Amen? It is a false gospel that teaches that there will be no adversity and no troubles and no persecution and no pain and no poverty and no sickness and no sorrows. That's a false gospel, because none of that's going to be true until after we've gone to be with Jesus in heaven. Amen? But until that time, God's word makes it plain that as Christians, we're going to go through adversity, we're going to go through tribulation, because that's what God uses to grow Christian character. Now, if you're thinking, well, if that's what it takes to be a Christian, then I don't think I want to be a Christian anymore. Sorry, but the truth is you're going to have to go through tribulation whether you're a Christian or not. But the difference is this: with Christ, we can overcome these things, and now they have a positive purpose in our life, because all things work together for good. Amen?
Amen.
See, the Bible says that the man that is born of woman is full of trouble. The man that's born of woman is full of trouble. So saved or unsaved, what it means by that is you're going to face all kinds of pressure in life, but the child of God is able to see that God engineers what happens to him, and as a result is able to say, we glory in our tribulations. I ran across a book a while back called If It Ain't Broke, Then Break It. That's an interesting book. The title kind of caught my attention, and it was a book written for business people, and it wasn't a religious book at all, but it was simply saying to business people, look, don't keep going through the same old ways just because you think that it's always worked that way before. You're going to have to do something different if you're going to succeed in the future. You're going to have to expand your thinking and your understanding of things. And he's trying to teach them to be new and innovative in the book. But the introduction of the book, there was a story that just captured my attention. And the writer didn't make any spiritual application, but we can. Amen? We can. So here's the first story of the beginning of this book. The book is called If It Ain't Broke, Break It. Here's what it says. It says, for several centuries, down through many dynasties, a village was known for its exquisite and fragile porcelain. Especially striking were its urns. They were as high as tables and as wide as chairs, and they were admired around the globe for their strong form and delicate beauty. Legend has it that when each urn was finished, there was one final step that needed to be taken. First of all, the artist then broke it. And then he put it back together with gold as the cement. An ordinary urn was then transformed into a priceless work of art. What seemed finished wasn't until it was broken. So here's a beautiful urn, and it seems complete, but then the artist takes a hammer and he shatters it. He just breaks it. He breaks it into a billion pieces, and then with gold filigree, a solid gold glue, he then puts it all back together. A while back, I was watching the program Antique Roadshow. I'm sure you've seen that show. It's an interesting show. Someone brought in one of those urns to be evaluated, and it was not only incredibly beautiful, but it was also worth a fortune. It was worth a fortune simply because it had been broken and remade with a gold filigree. See, men usually throw broken things away, folks, but I'm telling you, God never uses anything until he first breaks it.
Amen.
God won't use it and doesn't use it and really probably can't use it until he breaks it. Look at the next verse on your outline there, Psalm 51:17. The Bible says, the sacrifices of God are a what kind of a spirit?
A broken spirit.
A broken and contrite heart. Oh, God, you'll not despise those things.
Amen.
And so God's trying to break your life. I can tell you this, no preacher can preach for God as he ought to until he's been broken himself. Until he's able to preach from a broken heart. No preacher can preach like he should. And no singer can sing for Christ like they should until they sing from a broken heart. No congregant can sing and worship the Lord until they sing and worship from a broken heart.
Amen.
No teacher can teach as they even should until they teach from a broken heart. We glory in tribulation because our God knows exactly what he's doing when he allows pressure to come into our lives. So first of all, when God begins to build Christ-like character into you, the first place he begins is by allowing certain pressure to come to your life. And then step number two, here's step number two. God allows perseverance then to develop. He allows perseverance to develop. God allows perseverance to develop. Just write that in there. Perseverance. God allows perseverance to develop. Now look again at this next verse, Romans 5:3. It says, and not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance. Now, first of all, God allows pressure to come, and then that pressure in God's hands produces perseverance. You need to have the pressure in order to learn patience.
Amen. Amen.
Which is perseverance. The Bible teaches that God wants to build a character quality into your life known as patience or perseverance. We're talking about the same thing. Patience is perseverance. Perseverance is patience. Requires patience. Patience, it's the ability to persevere. It's the ability to hang in there. It means the same thing. In other words, to endure, to stay consistent, to not give up. What do you do when problems come? What do? When you are placed in the olive vat and the pressure's on? What do you do when you're in the juice vat and you're being pressed by the circumstances? What do you do when the artist creator takes the hammer and begins to break the urn of your life? What do you do? Well, the Bible says you're to develop a character known as patience or perseverance, a character of endurance. In other words, you're not to drop out. You don't quit. You don't give up. Some people give their heart to Jesus Christ, and then when trouble comes, they just sort of drop out. They just quit. Or they try to escape in some way. They'll take pills, or they'll drink alcohol, or use a needle. Or, tragic as it is, some use a gun. And they just end it all. That's their escape. They just give up. And then other people just get cynical, and so they just sort of shake their fist in the face of God and their cynicism, and the result is they don't grow in Christian character. They don't grow. In fact, they just begin to diminish as a Christian. So what do you do when problems come? You persevere. You don't give up. You patiently wait on God for what comes next. I'm telling you, God wants to teach you endurance. Folks, that's God's way of building within you a Christian or Christ-like character, and we need that today more than ever before. I have some quotes on your outline there about the importance of perseverance. Look at them. The first one is from Martin Luther King Jr. He says this. He says, if you can't fly, then run. If you can't run, then walk. If you can't walk, then crawl. But whatever you do, you have to keep moving forward. Amen?
Amen.
Don't give up. Don't quit. Here's another one. Winston Churchill. He said, if you're going through hell, keep going. I like that one. I think that's right. Right? I mean, the last place you want to stop if you're going through hell is in hell. Amen? So you got to keep going. Don't give up. Don't stop. Keep going. Look at the next one. Albert Einstein said, it's not that I'm so smart. It's just that I stay with problems longer. That's the ability to endure. To keep going. To keep persevering without giving up. Look at what the great football coach Vince Lombardi said. He said, the real glory is being knocked to your knees and then coming back. That's real glory. That's the essence of it. Folks, that's patience. That's perseverance. Though you get knocked down time and time again, you keep getting back up. Amen? You've got to keep getting back up. And look at this next quote from Calvin Coolidge, the 30th president of the United States of America. He said, nothing in the world can take the place of persistence. Talent will not. Nothing is more common than unsuccessful men with talent. Genius will not. Unrewarded genius is almost a proverb. Education will not. The world is full of educated derelicts. Persistence and determination alone are omnipotent. That means all-powerful. The slogan, press on, has solved and always will solve the problems of the human race. We've got to press on. Amen?
Right.
You can't give up. In other words, greater than talent, greater than intellect or education is the character quality of perseverance. The spirit within us that says, I will not give up. Christians and conservatives right now need to hear that message. We cannot give up or give in to what's coming against us right now.
Amen.
One of the great marks of your confidence in God Almighty is your ability to persevere and your ability to press on and keep going when trouble comes and when pressure is on. You don't give up. First of all, God allows pressure into your life, and then God uses that pressure to help build perseverance. And then comes step number three, and that's this number three on your outline there. God allows purity then to rise. God allows purity to rise. Can you turn the cooling packer down on these here, please, so they keep on right. Then look at this next verse again. It's Romans 5:4. It says, and perseverance, character. And perseverance produces character. And the word character there is in reference to Christ's character. So it has to do with purity. It has to do with the purity of Christ. In fact, some translations translate the word character as experience. In other words, pressures produce perseverance, which creates an experience, and that experience purifies. Are you with me? Did you get all that? I don't think you did. I think you're just nodding your head saying, yeah, we got to do that. Let's move on. No, because I want you to really get it. Listen to it again. Translation of the word purity here means character or experience, which means you're not going to get it without the experience of pressure, which means you're not going to get perseverance without the trouble, without the trial. The next time you call me and you say, Pastor, I got to tell you, man, things are really hard, things are really tough, I'm probably going to say, well, praise God. And you're going to say, what kind of a pastor are you? I'm going to say, good looking one. Amen?
Amen?
Because we're to glory in the tribulation.
Yeah.
Things are really tough. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
I hate it, I don't like it, but praise your name.
That's right.
Amen? Amen? See, we're talking about character that's pure. Not just being a character. Some of you are characters, but we're talking about a pure character. Amen? A character that has gone through the experience of tribulation, has gone through the experience of perseverance. Now God begins to burn out the dross or the impurities that's in your life. That's what repentance is all about. That's what confession is all about. Getting on our knees and recognizing what it is that God wants us to repent of. Confessing it, letting Him burn it out of our lives. See, if you're going through a troubled or difficult time, you better get before God and say, God, what do I need to confess? What do I need to repent of? Church, as a whole, you and I, we're individuals, but as a whole. When He said, if my people who are called by my name shall repent of their sin, I'm on those sides of prayer and repent of their sin. In other words, look, you better get on our face and repent whatever it is God says we need to repent of, or we're going to lose everything.
Amen.
Amen. And revival will never come until that happens, church-wide. We all have to be a part of it. However, most of us don't want to do that. Quite honestly, look, I've had all the trouble I want, but yet at the same time, I'm open to more. At the same time, because I don't want God to ever stop working in my life until He's finished, and He won't be finished until the day that He comes back. Amen?
Amen.
Now, the truth is, most of us would rather spend our life having a good time, but listen, how many of you really ever really grew in your spiritual life, in your Christian life, when everything was going smoothly just fine? I can promise you, I can tell you, probably none. And if you didn't grow, if you didn't grow, it was just so little that you didn't even notice the growth. It's very small. But yet how many of us have grown because of the heartache that we've had to face and because of the pressure and pain and misunderstanding and bewilderment that we've had to go through? How many of us have grown as a result of that? We all have. See, we all grow when there's no place left to go but to God.
Amen.
Those times when we had to keep searching our hearts and saying, God, what's wrong? Oh, God, what are you trying to tell me? God, what are you trying to teach me? God, what do you want me to confess? As God begins to raise the heat on the furnace of our lives, it causes the impurities of our soul to rise to the top, and then God begins to remove those impurities as we confess them. And it's said that a refiner of gold knows when the gold is pure because he's able to see his own reflection clearly in it. And so our God wants to see His character reflected in us as well.
Amen.
Look at the next verse, Job 23:10. It says, but He knows the way that I take. When He has tested me, I shall come forth as what? As gold. Job knew what it was to be in the furnace of affliction. Job knew what pressure was. And Job also knew what perseverance was. And so Job also knew what purity was.
Yes.
Because he persevered through it all. He was purified. Look at the next verse, Malachi 3:3. It says, He will sit as a refiner, God will, and purify, a purifier of silver. He, God, will purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer to the Lord an offering in righteousness. Somewhere I read this little poem. It said this, I walked a mile with pleasure, she chatted all the way, but left me none the wiser for all she had to say. I walked a mile with sorrow, not a word said she, but all of the things I learned from her when sorrow walked with me. That's true. Amen. It's true. See, God is in the business of building men and women of God. He's in the business of building Christian character. And how does God do it? Well, not by scrubbing the dirt floor, my friend. That's not how he does it. But first of all, by getting you saved and then putting the likeness of Jesus Christ in you. And then God allows a pressure to come into your life. And then that pressure causes patience. And patience then brings purity. And that brings us to the fourth step of how God builds Christian character. Here's number four. God allows the prospect of hope to grow. And God allows the prospect of hope to grow. He allows the prospect of hope to grow. The next verse, Romans 5:4, once again says, and perseverance creates character, and character, hope. Hope. God wants to build into you and I this precious quality of hope. And what is hope? Well, I can tell you this. Hope doesn't mean wish or desire. That's not what hope is. But it means having a rock-rooted assurance that based on the Word of God and on the character of God, I have this hope. See, how do you get hope out of affliction? How do you get hope out of pressure and perseverance and purity? Well, you go through these things, and then we come out the other side, and what we have learned is that God truly is faithful. Amen. That God is faithful, that He's still with us, and He got us through it. God didn't fail. And when that happens, then we can say what the Apostle Paul said in this next verse on your outline there, Romans 8, 38-39. We can say like Paul, for I am persuaded now that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to ever separate me from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. And everybody said,
Amen.
My friend, that's our hope. It's our hope. I looked up some definitions of hope, and I put them on your outline. I kind of like these. Here's the first one. It says, hope is faith in the future tense. And I kind of like that. Hope is faith just in the future tense. That's okay. Here's another one. Thomas Brooks said, this hope can see heaven through the thickest clouds. I like that. That's good. Here's John Bunyan. John Bunyan said, hope is never sick when faith is well.
Amen.
I like that. If you don't have hope, if you really don't have hope, then frankly, folks, you don't have anything. You don't have anything. In fact, hope is one of the greatest assets that you can have. Faith believes, but hope expects.
Amen.
Hope expects. See, a person who lives by confidence in God and God alone, no matter what, is a person who is growing in Christ-like character. Listen, the devil wants to blow out the light of hope in your heart and in your mind. He's trying very hard to do that in the life of the church today. He wants to diminish hope among us. So he tells you things like, you're just too sick, there's no hope. Or you're just too bad, you're too evil, there's no hope. Or he'll tell you that the situation, the circumstances are too desperate, there's no hope. The enemy coming against you is so overwhelming, there's no hope. But Satan wants to blow out every light of hope. I was reading about World War II in the North Atlantic Ocean, and there was an aircraft carrier out there, and they sent up six pilots in their planes to scout out for submarines. But night came, and the sonar aboard the carrier detected a submarine very near them. And so the captain aboard the carrier issued a command that every single light on the carrier had to be turned off. Otherwise, they would be a sitting target for that floating submarine. But the flight officer said, well, what about our boys who are out flying? They need landing lights. And the captain said, turn off every light. Those men who had gone out to scout the ocean finally came back, and they radioed to the carrier, turn on the lights so we can land. The man on the radio said, I'm sorry, but we can't do that. Another of the six pilots said, give us a light so we can land. We can't see. They sent back and said, we're under orders. We cannot turn on a single light. So a third pilot radioed in and said, give us one light, just one light, because we don't know where you are. We don't know how to get to you. And they sent back and they said this, we're sorry. The enemy has forced us to be in the dark. The enemy has forced us to be in the dark. And six brave American pilots went down in the cold North Atlantic Ocean and perished because they could not find one light in the darkness. There are a lot of people like that in our world today that are saying, will someone, somewhere, give us a light? Any kind of light. And they're believing all kinds but the true light. Where is the light of hope today? I want you to know that Jesus Christ is that life. He really is. But the Bible also talks about those who don't have any hope now. They can't see the life because they don't know about Jesus. They just don't. They don't know the true Jesus. Look at the next verse, Ephesians 2:12. Here's what Paul says. That at that time, you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. Look, without God, there is no hope. There are a lot of people in this world who are today just like we used to be. They are people without hope. Because they don't know Christ and they need somebody to help turn on a light so they can find their way in the darkness. They need hope. And their hope is in Christ. Look at this next verse on your outline there, Hebrews 6:19. God says, this hope we have has an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast. Read that with me out loud. Let's read it together. Here we go.
This hope we have has an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast.
A great ship will put down a huge anchor with the prongs of that anchor dropping to the bottom. And one of those prongs will go under a huge rock. It will get a hold of that rock, and that ship will be steadfast and secure.
Amen.
The writer of the book of Hebrews says, that's what our hope is like. Let the storms rage. Let the waves pound against us. Let the wind blow. But the anchor holds. In Russia, in Moscow, there is to this day the tomb of Lenin. Vladimir Lenin, the founder of the great Soviet Union, who died over 90 years ago, he died in 1924. But after he died, they embalmed his body in such a way that it still looks like Lenin did when he died. I mean, they placed his body in a crystal casket, almost a sarcophagus, and so that everyone could see him as they walked by him. And it's kind of a freaky thing to see because he died in 1924, but he still looks as though he died yesterday. And thousands of people walk by that casket every year to view the body of the founder of the Soviet Union. On that casket is written these words. Engraved in that casket are these words. Listen to these words. He was the greatest leader of all peoples, of all countries, of all time. He was the Lord of a new humanity. He was the Savior of the world. That's what's inscribed in his casket. The interesting thing about that inscription is that three times it says, he was. He was. He was. And yet there he lies, still dead. Because he was. He was. He was. Amen?
Amen.
Listen, my friends, Jesus Christ is. He is. He is. Amen?
Amen?
Jesus Christ is the true Savior of the world because though Jesus Christ died, he didn't stay dead. Jesus rose from the grave and he's alive. He is alive. He's alive today. Christ is risen. Amen?
Amen.
And he's here. And that is the rock. That is the anchor of my soul that holds you and I steadfast and sure in our hope. My hope is the resurrected Savior. And Jesus is the rock that my anchor now holds to. Here's what God wants to do. He wants to build that kind of hope in each and every one of us. And he wants to build it stronger each and every day. And he'll allow these kinds of pressures to come into our life to help us get to that place. He wants to build in you that hope in the future tense. And so here's the plan. Here's the way it works. Once again, first of all, God allows pressure, tribulation to come into your life. It's happening now, right before our eyes. Then comes patience or perseverance. We're learning to push through this. We're seeing what's happening. We're getting a clear biblical picture of what's really going on. But we're persevering. We're going through it. And we don't give up in the midst of the pressure. We don't quit. We don't walk away. We don't throw up our hands and say no more. So many Christians have walked away from church because of COVID. They're not coming back. They're not going back, but we don't do that, amen?
Amen?
We don't do that. And then because of that perseverance comes purity, the deepening of our character, the purging of that junk from our soul. Then comes the prospect of hope, a hope which is a rock-ridden trust and confidence in Almighty God. That's how God builds Christian character for us. My hope is built on nothing than Jesus' blood and righteousness. And I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but I only lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock I stand in. All other ground is what?
Sinking sand.
Amen, amen.
It starts when you get saved. That's when the light inside you gets turned on. And that light continues to burn brighter and brighter as God causes you and I to grow in Christ-like character. but it starts with yourself. If you are tired of just trying to scrub a dirt floor, and if you're just tired of trying to just get better and better and better, but no matter how much you scrub, nothing really changes. Nothing changes. If that's the case, then we need Jesus more than ever. Amen?
Amen.
And for those listening online, you need Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. You need to be born again. You need to be saved. Look at the last verse on your outline in Romans 5. Because it says this, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
If you've never really been born again, if you've never really accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you're just not sure that you're saved, then I invite you to pray a prayer like this. In fact, everybody just bow your heads and close your eyes for just a moment. Let's pray. Let's talk to God for just a second. You might want to pray something like this from your heart. Just say, dear Lord Jesus, I believe that you truly exist. And I know that you love me. And I know that you want to save me. Lord Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God. And I believe that you died for my sins. I believe that you were buried. And that you rose from the dead by the power of God. And I believe that with all of my heart. Lord, you told me in your word that if I would trust you, that you would save me. Well, right now, I do trust you, Lord Jesus Christ. And right now, at this moment, like a child, I ask you into my heart. And I commit my life to you by faith. I receive you now as Lord and Savior of my life. Take control of my life, Jesus. I give it to you. Come into my heart and save me. Now, Father, I pray that you would work in every heart today and do everything you can do. Lord Jesus, I pray that you would help all of us to grow in Christ-like character, to make the most out of what's happening around us now, to see that what you're really doing in the lives of your people is building a greater hope than we've ever experienced before if we'll just persevere and if we'll just allow you to purge the sin of our lives. We're going to come out on the other side with a stronger hope than we've ever had. Problems come our way now. Help us to see that they are opportunities for further growth. Possibilities. But we ask all this in Jesus' holy name. And all of God's people said,
amen.
Would you stand with me as we sing together? Let's finish this.